All right, hello everyone, and welcome to another episode of Annie's Replay Casting. I'll be your caster, Annie, aka Android, and this is going to be match number 22108056 28. Looks like it's going to be a good one here. We have got a classic Radiant Dire matchup, but some pretty interesting heroes to complete the picks. On the side of the Dire, we're going to have Dark Fox playing the Slardar. It's going to be very angry Russian characters playing the Necrophos. Up here in the top lane, we have got more smaller angry Russian characters playing the Luna. Here in the base, we have got medium length Russian characters on the Phantom Assassin. And finally, we have got Racist Horse on the Disruptor. On the side of the Radiant, it's going to be Admiral Brendong on the mid OD down here at the bottom rune. Going to be Zistara on the Crystal Maiden, Orphis on the Wraith King over here in the safe lane. We're going to have Gamer on the Night Stalker. Finally, it's going to be Feedlix on the Warlock. So to start things off, there's going to be a little bit of rune contest down here, a little bit of harass coming out, Phantom Assassin opting to level Dagger first. We got the Crush from the Slardar coming through, but there is a Wraithfire Blast ready on the side of Orphis if they need it. He's going to be going through 1v1ing onto the Phantom Assassin. The Wraithfire Blast will connect onto the Slardar, but a final Crush will secure the rune for the Slardar, so runes are going to be a 1-1 split going the way evenly of the mid heroes. Admiral Brendong might be in some trouble here, taking a Thunderstrike to the face. He's going to get out for now. Luna's one more right click will do the job. He's going to be able to get away, juking through the trees. Oh, Luna will get the first blood, just barely, that one click, and she's not even punished for it either, so first blood for Selimene indeed, as Dire gonna start things off a little bit stronger now, with the safe lane Luna getting a good amount of gold and XP going in her favor. In terms of overall lanes, we are going to have a defensive tri-lane down bottom. Orphis going to be the hard carry here. Feedlix and Zistara will be supporting him. Feedlix is going to need to rotate around. Warlock is not one of the heroes that does fantastically splitting XP three ways. Crystal Maiden needs to hop into the jungle. Does have the Frostbite level, so she can go onto creeps whenever she'd like. Keeping the stack and pulse going here, and you know, putting all your eggs in the Wraith King basket is really risky, but I think it may end up paying off. He's going to come online relatively quickly, and combine that with the raw right-click damage of an OD in the mid-game, it's going to be fantastic, but to put a stop to that, we are going to have Luna here in the safe lane position, leading up the last hit chart for the Dire as the first wave is coming to an end, and, well, she's doing pretty well. Already has the completed Aquila, courtesy of that first blood gold. So we're going to have a Phantom Assassin coming down here to farm. She's going to be splitting XP and farm with the Slardar, so it seems like maybe not a whole lot of communication going on in the Dire. They, you know, they picked a lot of heroes that are very farm dependent, very level dependent. Slardar can do just fine solo in the offlane. Phantom Assassin, you know, what niche is she going to fill? She's not really an offlaner. She doesn't need to be the solo safe laner because you've got a Luna who's going to outscale her in terms of damage. Looks like Luna might actually be diving deep. Holding onto the Lucent Beam will go in onto Gamer as Gamer takes a Thunderstrike. He's getting very, very low. He is going to be building up the Urn of Shadow, should have it soon, and he also has the Healing Salve if he wants to heal up. So, just back to the point about the Phantom Assassin, she's gonna be starving in terms of farm and level. She's not gonna get exactly what she needs here, as Slardar's always gonna be there to contest, to split XP. Slardar is doing better than PA in terms of last hits. He's got three, she's got one, but no one really has perfect CS. I mean, the top of the chart is going to go the way of the Luna. In the mid, Necro is doing pretty well in terms of CS. Admiral Brendong going in with some harass, but he's fresh out of mana. Has to be watching that a little bit. We'll be building up the Null Tally to get himself some more int, higher mana pool to start with, and hopefully that'll be enough for the Radiant to come online towards the mid game. There's going to be a dagger coming out onto Feedlix. He's going to be feeling A-OK, but again, Warlock is level 1. He's really level dependent. He's not able to fight until he hits 6, and the earlier the 6, the better. Meanwhile, Gamer here has to defend underneath his own tower, pops out the Void onto the Luna, and you know, he's going to be having a rough time here. Disruptor is a fantastic support to combine with the Luna, because you know, Nightstalker runs too far away. Just use that Glimpse and drag him back. There is going to be a max onto the Thunderstrike rather than the Glimpse, and no value point in Kinetic Field just yet. We'll see how Disruptor alters that as he gets more levels, but for now, you either want to see a 1-1-1 split for your first three levels, or 2 points into the Glimpse to get more range on that, because the Thunderstrike is alright, but it's really not how you're going to secure a kill. You want to be able to feed it to Luna with the Lucent Beam. Looks like Feedlix is going to take a dagger to the back. The Blink is going to connect as well, but they don't have any sort of mobility for Slardar to get in there. He does have the Bash, he does have the Crush, but no Sprint to be able to get closer, and that's not too atypical. It's pretty good for him to hold onto a point in Bash. He's only level 2, been forced out of the wave a lot, and of course has to split the XP with the Phantom Assassin. Not an ideal situation. Meanwhile, Wraithgang's having a clam of a time here. He's level 4. He's got pretty good items, and he's got some nice gold to work with. It looks like he will be rushing the Blink Dagger first item. He's holding on to over 1,000 gold in his pocket, so saving up for the big item, and that'll be really successful in terms of starting things off. Felix now might have to go and is going to be casting out the aggressive Shadow Word here onto Dark Fox, trying to get him low. The Frostbite is there from the Crystal Maiden. They've got the right click damage. Go through, hit him one more time. Just hit the creeps now as he's tethered to them. It looks like the Luna does end up picking off the Night Stalker off top, but Warlock does get down the Slardar down bottom, so it's going to be a one-for-one trade. I think, just in terms of fight recap, that's going to slightly favor the Dire, just because the Night Stalker is more of a juicy target, you know, and Slardar is not having a huge impact this game, so, you know, getting him down is... eh, he's now back in the fight, slithering back into lane. It cost him 100 gold to get back down here, so that's at least something. We are going to have PA and Slardar looking for kills here, but not really prioritizing farm and not prioritizing getting up and getting XP, which is going to be a real big deficit to come back from, as you have the Wraithking now, who's going to be halfway to level 5. Meanwhile, your Slardar just sitting on level 3, your PA. She's going to be at level 3 as well. There is going to be a nice crush connecting onto Dark Fox. Looks like he will take some serious daggers to the face, and he will end up going down, so he just bit off more than he could chew, trying to jump into 3 Radiant Heroes that had some serious damage going their way. I heard a bleep. I think I got a donation, so thank you so much for your generosity. Meanwhile, we are going to have Gamer in the top lane continuing to try to get his XP. He's doing pretty well here, going to be getting his level 6 very soon, and that nighttime is going to be doing pretty good for him. Meanwhile, in the mid lane, we did have Admiral Brendog getting down Necrophos, which is going to be a really nice pickoff. Necrophos was kind of being a bully here, going in, getting the harass. We saw it kind of come to a free-for-all, as Admiral Brendog did get very low. He's out of regen, so he's going to be scrambling back to base when this is all said and done to fill up his bottle. But he's got enough money for boots now. He's got enough money for another component of the treads, if that's the build he's going. And, well, he's going to be pretty successful here, as Necrophos is just not doing that much in terms of, you know, he doesn't have his bottle. He has his arcane boots, but no real reliable health regen, aside from the self. So Orphis is going to be going through, maybe trying to look for something. We'll take a dagger, but there's going to be no follow-up once again, as it's just a constant fight for last hits and farm, and Dark Fox and PA are not going to compromise, and it's really costing both of them their items. PA is building the typical carry build, but she's going to be delayed 10, 20, 30 minutes on whatever she builds, because she's just not getting free farm, not getting space. And Slardar, he's going to be saving up for his blink most likely, but it's not going to come out anytime soon, as he's been forced to buy up a lot of regen in this lane. Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Meanwhile, Orphis has completed treads. He's flying himself out a circlet as well to pick himself up some more stats, so we'll see if he ends up going for the blink dagger first, if he wants to go for something crazy like a first item AC. I've seen it before. It can work out, but you really want to get that mobility up on a Wraithking. Crystal Maiden, meanwhile, will be flying in her Tranquil Boots pretty soon. That'll help her out a lot with her health regen. She puts 2 points into the Arcane Aura, making sure her team gets what they need, and they get what they need indeed here, as we do have a unload of damage here, as there's a double kill on top. OD going through, gets the kill and the support disruptor, and then the Luna, which is also fantastic. They don't have to sacrifice Gamer, so Night Stalker runs away. He will have his completed urn when this is all said and done. Meanwhile, down bottom, Orphis continues to farm and get XP, so OD now coming online. If we switch over to net worth, Luna is still number one, but OD rapidly catching up to the second slot. It's going to be an aggressive Radiant position here. They want to go in for something. There will be a crush connecting onto both, so Dark Fox getting really, really good there. There's going to be a freeze. There's going to be a nuke there from the Crystal Maiden going through. Dark Fox falling very, very low with the Shadow Word from the Warlock. They will get the kill on that. Warlock ends up securing that kill. Crystal Maiden is still alive, just barely. Once she flies in the Tranquil Boot, she should be A-okay to stay in lane. So for now, just more successful pickoffs. Oh my god, blood everywhere. Mid lane, we did have the Sanity's Eclipse dropped as Outworld Devourer shows off a shiny new ultimate and takes down the Necrophos once again. So Necro now 0-2. OD made up for that early first blood, now has 4 kills to his name. He does take the top slot on the net worth chart, surpassing the Luna, who has had pretty much free farm this game until OD came to random her parade. So things are going to stagnate. Now, there is going to be Orphus walking very heavily into lane. He's got enough mana for the regen, and or at the respawn, and may have to use it. Dark Fox going in, sprinting up, and will end up taking the Warlock damage over time. Now, Felix getting kind of low. There is going to be the Wraithfire Blast comes out, saving up his mana, so he still has enough for the Reincarnate. Looks like Dark Fox may end up falling here. The right clicks of the Warlock reincarnates. So Orphus is now back up, full health, full mana. Maybe look to reinitiate onto the Phantom Assassin as OD joins the party here. He's got the Astral Imprisonment to hold her in place, but she gets back to her tower too soon. Meanwhile, up top, Nightstalker is able to take down the Luna for a second time. Oh, this cat lady's having a miserable time. Four Radiant Heroes down bottom, still not enough to secure the kill on the Nightstalker up top, so he's feeling really good. He hasn't opted to level his Darkness yet, which is a little bit unusual for a Nightstalker. It's a really powerful skill. You get that nighttime speed boost, and I bet he's wishing he had it now. He's gonna get glimpsed back. Actually, he might end up saving his life as the Necrophos goes in, but Gamer, once again, okay, that was a very aggressive push. He will end up getting picked off by the right click of the Disruptor. Static Storm is committed. Meanwhile, down bottom, Warlock does end up getting a kill on the Slardar down here. Luna, she is still level 5, no ultimate for her, so everyone on the side of the Radiant could end up continuing to push. You've still got a very healthy OD who's feeling like he wants to go in for an Astral. You don't have your Reincarnate on Wraith King. He's sitting kind of low, so maybe that's the hesitation. Maybe Radiant wanted to come up and defend this top tower that may end up falling. Looks like that will be the case. We have the OD rotating in first. He's going to go through, looking to catch out anyone with an Astral, but meanwhile down bottom, you still have the Wraith King farming. He's been farming the entire game, and it's really starting to show in terms of his net worth. Even with only one kill, he is holding the third spot very closely. Looks like a four staff will be picked up from the OD pretty soon. That's going to be a nice utility item. Racist Horse might be in a world of hurt. I don't know if the Radiant know that he's there. The Vision game is a little bit weak up top here. They've got some good wards near the Roche Pit, but Racist Horse now will be going in, having to take the raw damage of the OD. He's going to glimpse back the OD, but there is still going to be the Astral coming through for a nice setup here as Racist Horse frozen in place. One slap of the staff from Outworld Devour. Or actually, Nightstalker gets the kill from that. Either way, Radiant, they're grouping up. They're playing as a team. They're going to be cutting the creep wave as Feedlix goes in and right clicks. And Dark Fox confined here behind the tower. No Blink Dagger anywhere near in sight. In fact, Crystal Maiden is going in very deep. Crush connects onto two. There's going to be an ultimate from the Warlock, though, which Slardar is not long for this world. Looks like the tower is next to the menu. Feedlix needs to de-aggro here, or he might be in a world of hurt. Now he's going to go through, cast the heal on himself, and it's going to be a tier 1 cleanly in favor of the Radiant. They invest 4 heroes, but their 5th has still been farming flawlessly down bottom. We switch back to overall last hits. He is 2nd on the board, surpassed only by the Necrophos, who's now starting to fall off a little bit. He had a very successful mid lane, but after those 2 deaths, it's going to be hard. Down bottom, looks like Orphus might be in some trouble. He will die without the Reincarnate back off cooldown, so overall, the DD gank from the Necrophos does end up securing a kill. And Disruptor does end up grabbing the gold for that. That's going to be a pretty big bounty, 400 gold for this support dude. So for now, Dark Fox, he's really hunting for that Blink Dagger, but it's nowhere in sight. Meanwhile, the Four Staff is snapped up by the OD, so he's going to have that on top of his bottle and his boots. His net worth is now the highest in the game by a decent margin. It's only going to continue to scale as a Gamer. Making the space here, still holding on to the makings of an urn, I guess, but nothing else picked up for that. He's going to opt to go for the Ring of Health instead, maybe changing his plan halfway through. There's going to be TPs in from the Dire, so this might be time for the Radiant to back off. They do not have the Chaotic Offering. There's going to be Skulls flying after Gamer, but again, it's nighttime. He's soaring. Still no point in Darkness once he hits that level 9. I'd be very surprised if he decides not to pick it up. Feedlix TPing out. Nothing to break it yet, as there's no Blink Crush from the Slardar. Dire's middle tower. Morphus and Sistara are now focusing the mid lane. Racist Horse going to be coming through. Does have the glimpse pulling Orphus back underneath the tower, but there's no Static Storm to follow it up, and he does have the Reincarnate now in 20 seconds if he can live through this. They're going to try to get him down as quickly as they can, so he does not have the respawn. Sistara is going to go through. The Static Storm is going to be enough to take down Orphus, in fact, before his Reincarnate comes back off, so that's going to be twice now he's been punished for dying, and now there's going to be a defensive Astral on the OD, but I think it's time for the Outworld Devourer to head back to the fountain, although, yeah, they're going to go through. They do end up getting the Reaper's Scythe on him, so there's going to be no buyback, a long respawn time. That's not good if you're the Radiant. That fight recap was very cleanly in favor of the Dire. Almost 2k XP just going straight to them. Meanwhile, the tier 2 tower is going to take some serious damage. Most likely will end up falling. Radiant do have a fortify if they want to spend it. That's going to be the call, but that means if there's tier 3 damage after this, there's no fortify against it. Dire's bottom tower is under attack. We're gonna have a pause coming out from our Phantom Assassin. Gonna figure out what's going on there. Meanwhile, Warlock is just kind of doing his own thing here, smacking down this tier 1 tower. He does have the Chaotic Offering in 9 seconds. He could use it as a pushing tool. He may just want to back off, help defend his tier 3 as, well, the Radiant, they're gonna be able to bust through the tier 2 pretty soon, and they're gonna back off here. I think that's pretty key. They're not gonna overpush their advantage, not gonna overstay their welcome. Down bottom Warlock, he's going to be looking for his TP out, but now might end up getting punished by the Slardar. Slardar is now going to go for the Helm of the Iron Will, so most likely into an armlet before the Blink Dagger. We got the base being dropped here, Chaotic Offering committed against the Slardar, going to be going in for the push on the tower, and that could be some easy gold for the Slardar if he's not careful. Warlock will be punished here, not opting to TP out just yet. That's going to be a huge mistake. He's now going to be paying for that with his life. He had the freedom to get out here while his Golem was doing something, but maybe a little bit of micro distraction. The Golem, he's going to be hitting hard, but they are going to be able to take it out. Giving gold to Necrophos, that's going to be about 2k gold in Necrophos' favor. He could pick up a Blink Dagger. He could go for the finished Greaves recipe. We'll see what he ends up going for here. He's going to snap up a TP just to be able to get back to his lanes, and it seems like Radiant, they need to be pushing together. They need to be making the most of the fact that Wraith King is huge, OD is huge, and for right now they're not. They're letting Warlock get picked off alone. In fact, Nightstalker now, he's going to be alone as well. You've got multiple disruptors. You've got OD flying in to help the party start. Has the Sanity's Eclipse, has the Force Staff. We'll see if there's any pickoffs able to come. But again, Orphis off doing his own thing. We'll be pinged out by the Luna. Maybe she wants to try to solo this guy, but now that he's got 2 lives, it'll be a little bit difficult. Down bottom, we've got the Astral coming through. Dark Fox is going to be getting out here alive. Gamer ends up dying to the Static Storm. Killing spree now for the Disruptor. Orphis on the backlands will be able to secure the kill onto the Slardar, but there's going to be a Reaper Scythe into the Reincarnate, and now it's going to be Necrophos paying with his life. For now, Admiral Brendog will be getting out alive, takes a kill with him. Feedlix does end up falling, and Admiral Brendog goes in, force-staffing himself in for the triple. Smooth plays there by the OD. And that's exactly what you want. But meanwhile, Luna dropping the Eclipse, looking to get some sort of punish here onto the OD. Goes in with the Lucent Beam. He's going to defensive Astral himself up, maybe trying to go through. They do have the Wraithfire Blast now, killing off the Luna. The Luna wants to be able to find the OD, but she won't. It's going to be an Ultra Kill now from the Outworld Devourer. The only one getting out alive, or at least respawning early enough, is going to be the Slardar. He's going to TP into the top lane and go in for some jungle farm. So that was really well executed by the Radiant, but I'd say the keystone of that fight was that it was poorly executed by the Dire. Mid lane, we've got Disruptor TPing back. Disruptor, in terms of KDA, I feel like is probably close to the top. Yeah, leading the way for the Dire right now. 5, 3, and 4. The next closest is the Necro, but this Disruptor hasted up, holding onto the Static Storm, got a cooldown on that. He's really charging in to an aggressive position. There's going to be a TP in from the Necrophos going through. They are going to get a nice glimpse here onto Orphis, who does not have the Reincarnate. He's going to get very low and will pay with his life. So hasted Disruptor is able to pretty much essentially solo kill a Wraith King that just lasted in lane too long. So Sisydraw now TPing out, doesn't want to mess here. And we got Warlock and Gamer doing their own thing mid lane. There's going to be a Fortify. It will expire soon. They're probably going to be able to get the pick here. Ping out onto Dark Fox. They have Vision of him, courtesy of this Observer Ward here. And he's just going to be farming, so there's not a whole lot of pressure on the Radiant right now. Going to be finally securing themselves their mid tier 1. Dire's middle tower has fallen. So for now, it's going to be Necro and Disruptor kind of playing here. These are the two powerhouses on the side of the Dire. It feels like Luna, falling a little bit flat now, does have the Helm of the Dominator as well as the Ogre Club, so going to be going for that early BKB. But even then, you know, is she really last hitting that hard? We see the PA falling down once again up top. No surprise on that. PA has been, you know, she's building like she's getting free farm and she was given a lane to get whatever she wants, but she needs to adapt that and realize that she is absolutely playing from behind. There's going to be a glimpse back onto Orphis, so he's not joining the party just yet. You're going to let him continue to hobble in from the base. So that cheeky Disruptor play, buying a little bit of time for the Dire, making sure they get out safely. Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. Looks like Nightstalker opting to go for the Vanguard before he really finishes off the Urn, which is a pretty solid play. I mean, Crystal Maiden, she's got regen for days in terms of mana. She's got Tranquil Boots, and Well, OD, he's not really getting low anytime soon. Gamer, probably wishing he had that urn now. He's gonna be taking a Thunderstrike, locked in place, just absolutely, for lack of a better term, gangbanged by all five Dire Heroes, and the rest of the raid, you just kind of sit back and watch. You don't want the OD messing with that. Yeah, the sanities is good, but you can't take on five heroes now. A little bit of a late reaction time there from the OD. Forstack himself, trying to go onto high ground, does end up getting through the kinetic field before it really holds him in place. So it's going to be three Dire Heroes chasing down the Radiant. They do have the Crystal Maiden ultimate. They do have the Sanity's Eclipse, so there's a fair amount of burst damage if they want to go for it, depending on how deep the Dire chase. There's going to be another glimpse back. Do they just go straight for the Sanity's? The Static Storm's off the mark. Brendong might end up falling here. Goes in with the defensive Astral, trying to rotate, and the Crystal Maiden as well. Who's she going to freeze? She goes down for Racist Horse, but now just going to take a full-length Eclipse to the face. The Crystal Maiden goes down. Brendong, can he take anyone with him? No. Looks like there is going to be a double kill for the Luna. That's going to be a big advantage for the Dire in terms of fight recap. That's just a little bit sloppy from the Radiant. You gotta make sure, if you're bringing your Crystal Maiden in, go all in for the kills. Drop the Sanities as soon as you're done with the Astral. Try to get something out of it, but the little bit of hesitation there costing the life of the support and, in turn, the life of the carry as well. Now we've got Slaughter. He did opt to go for the armlet before the blink dagger. I mean, blink armlet are sometimes swapped back and forth, but now we're 20 minutes in and blink is absolutely nowhere done, and that's really gonna be costly for the Slardar. His crushes have been so powerful, and he can go in. He has max level bash, which it's great for farming. He's gonna be jungle farming for days, but how does he really have impact in these team fights? It feels like Dire's synergy is not there. They find a target they want, they chase them to death, and that's really it. I mean, the Disruptor, he's kind of a team player working with the Necrophos, but Luna, she's kind of off doing her own thing, again, trying to steal farm from the other carries. There's just such a split up of farm. PA playing like she's a core, but not getting the space to do so. Slardar not opting to go blink, so where's the mobility for the Dire? That's the real question. Meanwhile, we got mobility for days here. OD has the four staff. We got Wraith King going to be picking up a blink, hopefully relatively soon. Did opt to go for a Desolator before that, rather than a BKB. There is going to be a 4-staff in from Brendong. He does have the Astral if he wants to go in. There's going to be the Astral, but the glimpse back might be enough to get everyone safely out of the fight. There is going to be a Gamer walking in, walking right back out, deciding instead to focus the tower before the kills. Kinetic Field is going to come through. Both Gamer and Orphis are trapped inside, taking a full-length Static Storm. Is there going to be any follow-up here? The Reaper Scythe goes through. It's not enough to kill Gamer. We're going to have the ultimate drop. Feedlix going through. There's going to be a Crystal Maiden ult to follow it up as well, but the killing spree from the Luna is enough to take out the Crystal Maiden. So we're going to see everyone getting a little bit low here. Racist Horse now is the target of the damage, and will end up falling. Orphis may have to pay with his life again. That's only going to be a reincarnate. Dark Fox does end up falling in the backlands, courtesy of the Night Stalker. And Brendong still filling up, ready to go. Smacking in one more Arcane Orb is enough. And double kill now for the Orphis. Double kill now for Gamer. It's going to be a full five-man wipe in change for only the Crystal Maiden. And, you know, you hate to see Crystal Maiden fall, but that's worth it in that case. So for now, the Fortify comes out from the Dire. They're going to be going in, slapping down this tier 2. If we look at overall XP, what a sharp spike there in that last fight. It looked like Dire were able to get the big picks off onto the OD, onto the Wraith King a couple times, but by getting down all of the Dire heroes, you snap that net worth back right up in your favor. Gold, similar story. Four staff in from Brendog. He wants to go, and he's getting down the Arcane Orbs. Gonna go in with an Astral as well. Maybe looking to capitalize on this, but again, Racist Horus going through. Lots of damage coming out, but they are gonna get the kill on the PA. They are gonna get the kill onto the Disruptor as well. Kinetic Field popped out as a last word. Finally, we are gonna have an Eclipse coming through, doing a lot of damage, getting down the Night Stalker. Admiral Brendog might be up a creek without a paddle here. Has a TP, but where's the safe space to get out? He's just gonna go for it. It looks like PA will not be able to find him in time. Luna. His PA is still dead. Mid lane, we have Crystal Maiden going one for one up against a Necrophos. Gonna be using the ultimate as well, but that's not really how you play up against a Necrophos with Mechanism and Arcane Boots. Also the Mystic Staff as well, so he's perfectly survivable. Crystal Maiden now without an ult for the next 80 seconds. Maybe a little bit too YOLO, maybe wanted to wait until Orphis was able to rotate around with the Wraithfire Blast in the back lines. Looks like a Rosh attempt will now come out from the Radiant. Pretty well timed, they should be able to take it pretty quickly. Who do they give it to here? Do you want a triple life on Orphis, or do you want your OD to be more survivable? I think if I were in the position of the Radiant, you want to give it to OD, making sure Admiral Brendong doesn't die, because he's holding a huge chunk of the net worth, and Wraith King has kind of that built-in Aegis. But again, with only a level 2 reincarnate, you may want to give him that extra little bit of safety net if he just dives too deep in the fights. looks like Dire might be catching wind that something's going on. We're going to have Disruptor getting very close to his Aghanim Scepter as well. Needs about 1,000 gold on top of that. OD picking up the Aegis of the Immortal going through. Immediately, they're going to be able to find a fight here, pinging out the Disruptor. They want to find something. There's going to be a Force Staff in, but maybe not enough to catch anyone unaware. Luna, she's backing off. She's feeling pretty poor. She's got her helm. She's got her BKB, but she's sitting fourth on the net worth chart, being surpassed by a Wraith King as well as an OD. And those are both heroes that scale very well into the late game. It's not like you're being surpassed by a Zeus or something that tends to fall off after the 30-minute mark. These heroes are going to remain very, very powerful. So for now, Radiant's sticking together, grouping up, securing some nice farm there for Orphis. He's going to be picking up a Hyperstone, so could go into the Moonshard, most likely going to go for an AC. Meanwhile, we've got a Massacre going down as Brendog going to be going 1-for-1 against a BKB'd Luna, going in with the defensive Astral, letting the BKB run a little bit low. But with the Necro here, he's got the Reaper's Scythe. There's going to be a Glimpse back. This is going to be a dead OD. They're not going to commit the Reaper's Scythe. They're going to wait till the Aegis is burned. And can they lock him down a second time? This is ambitious from him. He got the Slardar, but is it really worth his life? There's going to be a Night Stalker rotating in from the back lines. The rest of the Radiant coming through as well. They're going to drop the Eclipse. Admiral Brendog will end up getting low. They don't get the Reaper Scythe on him. They are going to get the Reaper Scythe there onto the Night Stalker. And now it's going to be the rest of the Radiant trying to fare. They got a really nice Fatal Bonds going between three heroes, and Orphis whacking away from the back lines. They will get the kill, and now it's going to be a double kill now for Orphis. Can he get a triple kill? He's going in against the PA. PA trying to run away, but there's Fatal Bonds. They're going to go in the Wraithfire Blast. He can't hit through the net. That's going to be a triple kill now for Orphis. They lose the OD. They lose the Aegis, but so far, still worth as the Wraith King is continuing to come online. So Slardar, he's... Please tell me this isn't a Midas. This is a terrible idea if he is going for the Midas. He could be going for the Power Treads, which I would agree with more, but I think, again, just the raw mobility of a Blink Dagger is unrivaled. Crystal Maiden did opt to pick up the Aether Lens, which is not a 100% typical build on Crystal Maiden. Usually you want to see your ultimate accentuated a little bit, so you go in for something like a Glimmer Cape. You could go for a BKB or an Axe, those are both a little bit greedy in this situation. You could go for a Blink, a Force Staff, even a Ghost Scepter to keep yourself healthy in these engages. The Aether Lens will obviously help with the Frostbite, but I don't know if that's really the setup she needs. So for now, we are going to have Brendog going through. We'll be picking up a Hex, as we have the Ultimate Orb and the Mystic Staff. So that's going to be some nice lockdown going in favor of the Radiant. They're going to go through. They do have the BKB now popped onto the Luna. Luna is sitting here with a Lucent Beam. Brendog, again, pushed up so aggressively without a whole lot of backup here. Going to drop the Sanity's Eclipse. They will get the kill on the Crystal Maiden, but that's going to be a Reaper's Scythe on the OD. Again, just needless kills from the Radiant in terms of fight recap. That was a huge loss in terms... That's 3k XP going in favor of the Dire, and you give both of those kills to Necrophos that can actually use that and scale up well. He picks himself up his own Mystic Staff. He's had that for a little bit. He could be going for an Octarine as well as a Scythe of Ice. He's really not locked into anything. We see those two kills causing a little bit of a sharp turnaround in terms of overall XP and net worth. OD needs to start playing safe, even though he's with a Crystal Maiden. They are both incredibly squishy and at this point easy to get down. Orphis goes through. He's sitting really comfortably on the top of the net worth chart, but with that last death on OD, he now falls to the fourth spot. Luna and Necrophos sitting pretty close, surpassing him. Orphis will continue to scale pretty well, but OD needs to make sure he doesn't make any more mistakes, because he could continue to fall down and lose relevance. Gamer, meanwhile, picking up a BKB. The Night Stalker seems very fragmented in the sense that, you know, he started to build an urn and then stopped, and then he started to build maybe a Crimson Guard and then stopped, and then now he's going for a BKB. He's most likely going to finish that, and that'll be pretty successful, but I'd like to see him level up the Vanguard into a Crimson Guard to have some impact for his team, because he's playing the position 4-ish kind of role and supporting and going around for the kills and being really fantastic, but what does he really add to team fights right now? Yeah, he's kind of hard to kill. He adds a lot of mobility and vision, but Does he add damage? Not really. Does he add team fight abilities? Not really. So you either want him going for the Ags to be ultra utility with the vision and to help the team fight start, or you want him to go ultra aura and have him pick up something like a Vlad's into a Crimson Guard, into a pipe, or something like that that can help out your team. So for now, Warlock, he does have the Aghanim Scepter. That's going to be a nice pickup. So double Golems in this next fight breaking out. It seems like Radiant haven't had a whole lot of chances to cohesively go in as five and unload their team fight together, because that can be fantastic. If you get four or five people tanking up that Chaotic Offering and then drop Ascendity's Eclipse on top of that, boom, you got a four-man wipe at least. So we'll see how that goes. We have seen more successful team fights come out on the side of the Dire as they have that nice Static Storm with the Glimpse combo into a Luna ultimate. Phantom Assassin, she's going to be finishing her BKB relatively soon as well. That'll be a nice item for her to have, but again, it feels like she's playing from 10 minutes ago. She just didn't get the farm she needed in the laning stage. She's going in and working the jungle, but so is Slardar. They're still fighting for farm here at 30 minutes in the game. No one's established who the real leader is. God, please tell me this isn't a Slardar Midas. He's saving up a lot of gold. It's making me nervous. A late Midas on a Slardar? That's... it's not the way to get back in this. Yeah, it'll help his levels, it'll help his farm a little bit, but how late do you really need to go to make up for a 30-minute Midas that comes at the cost of your Blink Dagger? I think the Blink Dagger would help you get kills, which it can also get you caught up on farm and XP just as quickly. You get a couple nice pickoffs on Admiral Brendog, you get a couple nice pickoffs on the Crystal Maiden, even the Night Stalker. That's going to make up for the XP and gold your Midas would have given you. Brendog is going to go and they reveal the smoke, and Dark Fox is just absolutely destroyed. Wraith King, man, that Desolator is just chunking through armor like it's nothing. So this guy, he's got the armor in his favor. He's got the negative armor in his favor as well. So he's kind of a murderer. And we'll see if he's able to hold on to that pretty surprising lead now, as Luna, she's been doing her best to keep farming, and Luna does scale extremely well into the ultra late game. We've got a nighttime from the Night Stalker. We'll see how this goes for the Radiant. They want to go in for the push here. They want to get down their tier 2 tower mid. Maybe even start pushing on high ground as Slardar is still dead. But, I mean, Luna cannot be underestimated here. She is having the Eclipse ready to unload. She's going to be building into the Manta as well. She's got a BKB with 8 seconds left. So this is one scary kitty. Radiant opting to back off after they got their objective, safe that they're not going to push too far and lose their lead. I've seen so many games where a team finds a little bit of momentum but just way over pushes it, way overstays their welcome, and well, Radiant aren't going to do that. They're going to get back to farming here, and Wraith King, he's going to hold on to his lead at the top. He's got the Blink Dagger, he's got the AC like we talked about, and that's going to mean that he continues to get fantastic pickups here, and he can hop in and out of fights that are advantageous for him. Whereas, you know, the limited mobility of the Dire means that, you know, once they take a fight, they just kind of have to stick with it. And we are going to see Orphus going in with the Blink, with the Wraith Fire Blast, going through. There's going to be a Glimpse back and a BKB from the Luna. She's going to drop the ult. The BKB from Gamer doing a little bit of work here again. So he's chunking the Luna down. In fact, Dark Fox now gets frozen in place, can't go in. There's going to be a... oh, man. So much damage coming out. The Static Storm on top of the Chaotic Offering. There's going to be a Reaper Scythe coming through, but Gamer is still alive. Lives through the Scythe, does end up falling on the back lines. Crystal Maiden, her dance is interrupted by her death. And there's going to be a Glimpse back, and well, Feedlix once again having a little bit of micro troubles, and looks like Orphus is just gonna be raking in the kills in the back lines. Now the upheaval comes through. Admiral Brendog comes once again with the Astral, is ready with the Arcane Orbs to slap down and do the damage onto the PA. The Blurry keeping her a little bit safe for now. The mischance is fantastic. Do they have another Astral? Just going through with the Four Staff. That's gonna be a triple kill for Orphus, and OD gets a kill on the Phantom Assassin. So overall, Wraith King just kind of taking out the trash as they get another wipe here onto the Dire Heroes. It's time to push high ground as all the exterior towers are down. Dire's top tower is under attack. So these double golems are still reasonably healthy, very much alive for the next 5-10 seconds. They're going to get down to tier 2 tower, going to go in for the Rax. A little bit of split decision on which Rax they're going for, but they're not going to pay the ultimate price as they have plenty of time to take out both the melee and ranged. Now there is going to be a Hex here onto Dark Fox, going to Astral him up as well as he's still in pig form. Do they have any more lockdown though? Dark Fox will take a Wraithfire Blast, the upheaval keeping him in place. Orphus going through, will take a Crush. Actually may end up falling here, but still has the Reincarnate, and a Luna pop in the BKB so close to Fountain. This is going to be pretty nasty. The Moonglare is bouncing around, and well, that kitty wants to secure some fancy feast, but Orphis is backing off. Still has the double life if he needs it. Feedlix, he might not be so lucky. He's a little bit easier to bring down. Only 14 armor, only 1800 HP. Luna is going to go and has the Lucent Beam. We'll catch him out right at the edge of the range, but another hex from Admiral Brendog. He's going to take a Reaper Scythe to the face, but he's A-okay as he was pretty full health. They're going to pop the Reincarnate, but the rest of the Radiant team has backed off. Orphis bit off more than he could chew. He's now stuck in a Static Storm. He's going to be surrounded on four sides, and Brendog deciding whether or not to go in and bail out his teammate, but decides better of it, and there's going to be a glimpse back. They do get Feedlix once again, so a Radiant, that split second of indecision on whether or not to take the fight further really cost them a lot there. They lose their Wraith King, and that was huge. That was 3k gold in favor of the Dire, and almost 5k XP. Haste. Now, Hasted Crystal Maiden, she does have the Ghost Scepter and the Glimmer Cape, so all those utility items that make her ult so much better, and she's going to be able to finish her dance now as the Freezing Field may end up channeling all the way through. It is going to be just level 2. Level 3 hasn't come about yet. Radiant are very interested in the Roshan, but they don't have any vision on the high ground. They don't know where Dire are. They're coming through. There's going to be no Reaper Scythe. There's going to be an Octarine on the Necrophos, so well, he's having fun with his regen. Both teams figuring out when the smart time to take Rosh is, because it's a very contested objective right now. Pretty much anyone on the Radiant could benefit from the Aegis spare. I'd say Crystal Maiden, you really don't want to put it on her. Warlock as well is playing more of a hard support position than Warlocks typically do, not going in for aggressive solo picks or anything like that. So you can give your Aegis to Wraith King, Nightstalker, or OD and have it be equally useful, whereas on the side of the Dire, Phantom Assassin isn't doing enough in the fights to make it worthwhile. Slardar still has no mobility, so where is his kill potential going to come from? You really only want to put it on the Luna or the Necro, and looks like Necro is going for a Blade Mail. We'll see how that works out for him, trying to return all the damage he takes. Luna continuing to farm up. She now has the Manta and 1600 gold to play with. Still needs a little bit of buyback. Might want to save that, as again, there is a full lane of racks taken down in favor of the Radiant. The Radiant are grouping up. Do they have a smoke or anything sneaky here? They're just kind of walk into it. OD has picked up a Demon Edge, so most likely going for the MKB up against the blur of the PA. We saw how obnoxious that can be in the fight here in the high ground, but we'll have to see. Maybe we're in Rapier territory at 36 minutes in the game. Felix goes in. Knight's Observer Ward popped down from him there. And a Nightstalker also has his own Hyperstone, most likely going for a Moon Shard. You really don't need double ACs, as your Wraith King already has one, but maybe there's just a little bit of miscommunication going on, as Moon Shard Nightstalker isn't too typical. AC Nightstalker I've seen a lot more, but again, AC already exists on the Radiant. This Roshan is melting fast. The Dire, they're clumping up. They're getting ready to do something about it. They've got the Eclipse on the Luna. They got the BKB as well, but they're too late. They are going to give the Aegis again to the Outworld Devourer, and now Radiant are ready to fight. Garter goes in with the BKB, starting to smack up. They silence up the Necrophos. It's going to be a Static Storm as well, and now Blink in from the PA, actually doing a lot of work. Orphis may have to spend his first life here. In fact, he will go down. The Reincarnate goes through. He's going to be heading back in. Crystal Maiden, she's dancing on the back lines, but the Eclipse goes through, does a whole lot of damage. Crystal Maiden is so low, may end up falling here, and now it looks like Warlock is on the menu, trying to get out here, trying to get that Shadow Ward to heal him up, but it's not enough. And Crystal Maiden, she ends up falling too. Nightstalker as well, and looks like Orphis is able to get some serious kills after he respawns, but they had to burn the Aegis, they had to burn the Reincarnate, and they had to burn three lives on the side of the Radiant to be able to get down the Luna and the PA. Looks like they want to get the kill into Slardar, but he finally has that Blink Dagger. He's finally able to blink away from danger. They have to sacrifice a tier 3 tower after we finally get these gigantic golems to go through. Okay, so Admiral Brendog goes in, gets the kill onto Slardar, and then kindly gets glimpsed back by the Disruptor. So he's pretty thankful for that. Now Orphis needs to be careful. Still 3 seconds till Reincarnate. Gonna get Astraled up. May end up just wanting to sack himself to neutrals or something to get his full health and mana back with the Reincarnate. But, well, for now, he's gonna be getting back. He'll feel pretty safe. He's reasonably tanky there. Again, with the AC, he's got like 26 armor. I can't do a whole lot of math, so let me know if that's right or not. And, well, Brendog, yeah, again, he continues to use that scythe of ice. He is picking up the demon edge. He's got like 4k gold, so if he does want to finish off the Monkey King bar, now is the time. He's gonna be taking that nice coup de grace dagger right to the face, and Orphis, again, has to spend the reincarnate. There is gonna be a TP in from the Necrophose, so looks like Orphis is on his own. He finishes off the Rax. He's gonna have to pay the ultimate price for this. The Reaper Scythe comes through, and that's what's gonna kill him. That's gonna be a really long respawn time. So for now, we've got a Warlock who did finish off the Refresher Orb a while back, and that's really advantageous for him. Now he's got a billion golems into the fight, and we'll see next time he drops the base how effective it is up against Dire, because Dire do have a lot of single target damage. They've got the Luna, they've got the PA, now that even the Slardar are starting to hit relatively hard, so they might be able to take out the golems before they're a real problem for the base, but with two lanes of super creeps going in favor of the Radiant, I'd say this is a slow and steady victory for the Radiant, unless they make some huge blunders. In terms of overall XP and gold, XP is actually relatively even. I'd give that to the fact that Dire have gotten some really impressive picks on huge Radiant cores, and also the fact that Radiant have clumped up for a good amount of the game, not getting as much experience as they could be. But gold heavily, heavily in favor of the Radiant at this point in the game. Radiant structures are fortified. Dire, they're going straight in for the towers, not even looking for picks. There is going to be the base dropped, as Luna going to be dispelling the stun with her Manta style. She's going to drop the Eclipse, but not really connecting with a whole lot of heroes. There's going to be more golems joining the fight as the Refresher Orb is revealed on the side of the Warlock. Gamer will die to the Scythe, but not before he takes out the Luna on the back lines. They do end up losing the OD, which is a huge pick. Does he have buyback? Looks like not enough, just barely. So for now, Radiant take a lost fight. They are going to lose the Crystal Maiden as well. The Golem's going to go through. Golem's going to be able to give the Warlock a triple kill. There's going to be a Blade Mail now, preventing any further Golem damage on the side of Warlock. But that was just unnecessary death from the Radiant. You need to make sure your OD has buyback instead of buying out for these fights. There's going to be a TP back from the Necro, defending against the creep push in the bottom lane. And for now, Radiant, they have to reset. They didn't lose any map objectives. The tier 3 takes a little bit of damage, but nothing major. So they have the opportunity to sit back and breathe and figure out their strategy, because clearly what they've been doing is no longer working. The Dire are able to live through it. Racist Horse here, having some trouble with wave clear. And again, just looking at the wave clear, no one is really ideal. I mean, Luna, with the Moonglaives, will have the easiest time dealing with super creeps, but, I mean, we see now the Disruptor cannot 1v1 a super creep. They've got more hit points. Barely. So Necro, he's doing what he can, again, with the Death Pulse. It's gonna clear out a big chunk of the wave. Luna's gonna be our best farmer and should really benefit from the gold, but now it's up to Dire to make all these lanes push back. It's gonna be pretty difficult, because you always have to keep your Luna invested in the fight. Everyone always has to have a TP versus the Radiant that feel a little bit freer to move about the map because they have all their lanes pushing for them. Looks like Phantom Assassin will finally move her Quelling Blade to her stash. She does pick up the Skull Basher, so looking to maybe level into Abyssal at some point, but that is still a far ways off. There's going to be a defensive blink back from Orphis, and rightfully so. He's got some nice map awareness, figuring out that, you know, hey, we haven't seen Luna in a while. This ward does scout out some movement as well. So Luna looks like she will be going for the Butterfly. She's getting pretty close. Just does need that Talisman of Evasion, so she's about 200 gold off from the Butterfly, and that'll really help out, just making sure that everyone's, you know, evading a little bit more. But again, there's already an MKB on the side of OD, so the evasion isn't going to do a whole lot up against his right clicks. In the jungle, we do have a ping out. Necrophos going to be walking back. He does have the completed blade mail like we saw in the last couple of engages. He does also pick up the defusal now, and that'll be alright. I don't know if it was the item here. I'd like to see him pick up basically anything but that. Even the Aghanim Scepter, I feel like, would be a little bit better. Looks like Warlock will be building up the Octarine Core, just waiting on the Soul Booster to finish up, so he needs about 500 more gold, and that's going to be a very, very survivable Warlock. I mean, he's already got his luxury, or the items that he needs, so he can go for something a little bit more luxury. I'd like to see him get mobility in the form of a Blink Dagger, maybe even a Force Staff or a Yules, but, you know, it's his choice, and he's certainly successful as he drops the first set of Golems, gonna be getting a kill immediately on that. Double kill goes the way of Brendog, now has to take a full Eclipse to the face, going in with a defensive Astral to try to wait out the Eclipse going through. The BKB from the Luna is popped. There's gonna be a second set of Golems now, Refresher Orb doing its work. Feedlix, again, struggling with the micro, will end up dying. So Warlock does end up going down there, but gets off both sets of Golems, now doing some serious damage to Luna. Needs to watch how much gold they're feeding the Luna, as Gamer's going to go in with the BKB. They're going to go through, they're going to get the kill on the Luna, and the Static Storm not going to be holding anyone in place. Racist Horse might get the kill onto Brendog, as long as he, one more tick. Oh, fantastic Astral, making sure he lives through that. Warlock might want to put the Golem on any of the small buildings here, on the Effigy or anything like that, but... We'll figure it out. This Golem's just gonna sit back and enjoy the high ground. Meanwhile, there is gonna be fantastic playing here. Crystal Maiden finally channeling a nice ult, getting a lot of damage returned to him by the Blade Mail, and they're gonna get the kill on the Necro as well, so this looks like it's going to be it, as Dark Fox is now confined to the base. Slardar puts the Gloves of Haste in the stash, never to be seen again. What looks like it was a Midas is no more, as the final lane of Rax is finished off, and against Mega Creeps, I really don't think Dire have any shot against this. The Mega Creeps themselves are going to be pretty phenomenal. Dark Fox blinking in with one last attempt at the Crystal Maiden's life. She's gonna go with the Glimmer Cape, and Dark Fox will be picked off. And now the Tier 4s to follow suit. The Ancient is exposed. In terms of Mega Creeps, they now have 1270 HP, which is pretty much the same as the Disruptor. And Gamer, maybe diving a little too deep into the fountain, will die, but just as the Ancient falls down. So Radiant, they take a successful victory here. I think that comes down to the raw power of the Wraith King was just more than enough to carry them into the late game. The OD had some fantastic plays as well. Great rotations from the Night Stalker. But it also comes down to the fact that Dire misplayed a lot of those fights. Even in their draft, the PA was kind of unnecessary there. You would have wanted to see maybe another roaming support rather than a person that was trying to farm like a core and didn't have space. So the fact that Slardar and PA were competing for farm all game just meant that, you know, you have two halves of a core, but not really anyone that was fully online. So overall, again, Radiant victory. Great playing all around. I hope you enjoyed the cast. If you have any feedback on how I can improve, please feel free to reach out either in the comment section here or on Twitter at Android. If you'd like your own replay casted, please feel free to email me with your match ID at anycasts@gmail.com. So again, thanks for watching and have a great day.